Hello everyone, good afternoon. I'm so happy you all came here to listen to those three wonderful projects that have been nominated, and I'm proud to present you one of them about integrated STEM education, together with my colleague Jolien. Now first, before we talk about integrated STEM education, I want to ask you a question. In this slide, you see children, and they have a dream job. And I'm just wondering, what was your dream job when you were in elementary school? Did some people want to become a firefighter or policeman? Raise your hand. No one? No one likes adventure? Oh, there's one. Okay, great. Okay, did somebody want to become a pop singer or an actor? Yeah, of course, right? Okay, did somebody want to become a pilot or an astronaut? Yeah, that's great. A doctor or a nurse? Yeah, I know, because I met a few nurses on the bus to the school visit, and they were really nice, so I know there are nurses here. Scientist or engineer? There are, okay. And the last question, I'm really sure you all wanted, or most of you wanted to become a teacher? Yeah, of course. Okay. So that are the dream jobs, actually, of children when they're in elementary school. Athletes, astronaut, pilot, scientist even, they want to become. For girls, it's a bit different. Teacher, veterinarian, doctor, nurse, singer. Half of those jobs need STEM knowledge, at least a basic STEM knowledge. So that's very interesting, because when those children grow older, you see something else happening. According to European study, we lack, when we are an adult, at the adult age, we lack STEM professionals. We lack doctors, nurses, teachers, and ICT professionals. And many of those jobs, again, require a basic amount of STEM knowledge. So what happens with us when we grow older? Why don't we become those STEM professionals we need? Well, there are many reasons, and one of them is that our interest in STEM, or in science and math, is declining. Many studies, TIMSS studies you might well know, show that interest in science and math declines according to age. So, and especially in Flanders, in Belgium, we are from, at the age of 18, when half of the children have been studying STEM in secondary school, they turn their mind and want to become something else when they go to the labor market or higher education. Another thing we have been observing in another study, not ours, we didn't do the study itself, but other researchers, they concluded that half of the students in secondary schools in developed countries also believe that school science does not make them see why science is so important in life. And we believe that it's not only the problem for science, but also for math, for technology and engineering. And that's a problem, because all those challenges we are facing today and in the future, we need STEM professionals for, to solve those challenges, to tackle those challenges. Challenges like energy problems, mobility issues. We are also facing an aging society. And STEM professionals are needed, but not only STEM professionals. We also need people who are not specialized in STEM, but are able to work and to collaborate with STEM professionals. So we need both. People who are able to work together and work interdisciplinary. To make an example, to make a concrete example of how you need interdisciplinary knowledge, you can see this picture you saw yesterday in the elevator pitch. It's a picture of a museum with a burglar. We don't want a burglar there, taking out all those treasures from a museum, so we need a security system. You know, all those laser beams, I know you have seen already movies from James Bond, Johnny English, and all the laser beams going on there, and bad people or even the good people trying to steal something. Well, if you want to make that kind of, if you want to make that kind of security system, you need to know optics. You need to understand how light works to make that kind of laser beams. You need to know math, because you have to calculate how those laser beams have to be reflected in the room, because you don't want Johnny English or the other bad guys trying to steal something. And you need electronics. because you have to build a security system. So you see, if you want to solve a security issue, for instance, but also other challenges, you need knowledge of many disciplines together. Now, what happens at school, when children are still at school, they don't work interdisciplinary. They get subjects separately, math, science, like physics, biology, chemistry, and some of them sometimes get technology and engineering. Half of the students studying in STEM in Flanders don't get even technology or engineering as a subject at all. They all get those things separately at school. They don't see how real life works and how you have to integrate this kind of knowledge to solve problems. So that was the aim of our project, to provide learning materials that integrated STEM knowledge and let students make those challenges and solve problems together by using different knowledge of different disciplines. And that's why we believe that if you do this, they can really understand how STEM works in real life. They can increase their STEM knowledge, and also probably, hopefully, they get more motivated. So that's why we made learning materials, learning modules for secondary schools from 9th to 12th grade, dealing with many challenges. The security system in the museum is only one example. We also made other examples. Jolien is going to talk about, for instance, building a car that drives autonomously through a green wave. And this is important because when a car drives through a green wave, we can avoid traffic jams. We can decrease gasoline fumes. So this is a challenge. Jolien will explain further how it works in a classroom.
So we want to show students that multidisciplinary, that real life problems often can only be solved in a multidisciplinary way. And so this is an example of the first learning unit we developed. As you can see, students get a long road with three intersections. And at each intersection, there is a traffic light in one direction. Students also get the distance between the intersections and a maximum speed limit of 19 kilometers an hour. They also get the timeline of the traffic lights. As you can see, they work simultaneously. So simultaneously, they have the same cycle of green, orange, and red. Now, this is a real-world problem, but we want students to build it. So we have to rescale it. Students will have to make a scale model. That means the distances will be scaled. Also, the timeline will be scaled. And from these two, a new maximum speed limit can be calculated for the students, their car. And so students have to build a car and program it in such a way that it drives at such a velocity and acceleration that it goes each time to one of the green lights of the traffic lights. Doesn't matter which cycle they choose, but it must go through a green light without stopping. Now, so we are actually asking them to build a green wave, and the question is, what is the optimal constant velocity for the car to drive through? We can represent this in a graph in which the position of the car is set out in function of the time, and also the traffic lights are marked at the position line. And then students can calculate by means of the definition of velocity, they can calculate a certain speed. For example, if they rescale it to the large model, they see a velocity of 468 kilometers an hour if they go to the first green light of each traffic light. But of course, that is way too much, because if they rescale the 19 kilometers an hour, they get this curve. And so this is not possible, or they will get a huge fine. But there are other possibilities. As you can see, there are other velocities that are possible as well. And so, actually, we get an open-ended problem. Students can get several solutions. An open-ended problem is also an important characteristic of real-world problems. Now, so at the car, there's a motor that is connected to the wheels. And this motor has to be programmed. We use Arduino for that. That's very suitable for students. And it goes with a program, and students have to code the velocity in this program. So as you can see, we are modeling the same concept by means of several representations. Now, another possibility is that they choose a constant acceleration. That's also possible. There are multiple possibilities, of which a few are not allowed, because, again, the velocity will get too high. Again, students can program this. The program is a little bit more sophisticated, and it is also based on the definition of acceleration. And so you can see that students learn to use scientific concepts like velocity and acceleration by means of mathematical tools like equations and graphs in technological applications. And this is essentially what integration is about. I brought a little video of students who programmed a constant velocity. We have a little problem with the technology. As you can see, it drives through the green wave, the first, the second, and the third cycle of the green wave. And I think it is at maximum speed limit. Here, students made a contest. I hope it's, yeah. So they programmed acceleration. So you see the car slowing down and then, you can't see it, and speeding up again. And you can also see in the curve what it looks like. But we also create challenges that are even more relevant to society or to the environment. For example, students have to build a scale model of a passive house that is heated with a sun boiler. And now the question is, how do we get the highest efficiency for this sun boiler? So students will have to ask themselves questions like, okay, which shape should I put it in? Which materials should I use? And which fluid is the best one for this sun boiler? So they are engaged in inquiry-based design because they have to set up a lot of experiments in order to get the optimal design. Here you can see also a picture of one of the end results. The sun is replaced by a lamp. And you can see the different components of this this design. I will give Heidi back the word.
Thank you, Jolien. So that's how the learning materials work. This was a concrete example. Now, those learning materials, we as researchers didn't make it alone because, thank you, 5 minutes left. We made it together with teachers because we think it's important to incorporate the perspective of the teacher who is going to use then the materials when they're ready. So we worked it together and to develop the learning materials, and we worked together with teachers from 10 schools to develop a couple of years learning materials. Afterwards, we collaborated with teachers of 30 schools to test and implement and try out those learning materials. But because we are a practice-oriented project, but we also are a research project, so we wanted to know what the effect of the learning materials we have developed, what the effect is, and do research about it. So we also cooperated with 10 schools who were prepared to be a comparison group, a kind of control group. They were interested in applying also the materials we developed, but they had to wait, and so that we could compare the effect of the materials in integrated STEM with traditional way of teaching STEM. We did the research in many ways. Qualitative research methods we applied, quantitative ones, and we have collected many data over the last 3 years, and we didn't analyze yet all the data, but the first indications of our results are that students, and that was our first aim, are really getting more engaged in STEM. They're really getting more motivated. Teachers telling us that students don't even want a lunch break. They just want to continue to work on their project. They're so enthusiastic about it. Our quantitative data show similar results. Not only the teachers saying it, but also quantitative data. We have done it fully statistically with control designs, and we see an increased interest in science and technology. Interestingly, also, there's a perceived difficulty. We see an increase among students who follow integrated STEM. They think math is more difficult. They think it more as difficult than students in traditional STEM. It's interesting because at the same time, students doing integrated STEM are also better in applying math concepts in new contexts and integrating as well with physics. So that means that students are doing really real-life situations and challenges that they can become better in applying knowledge, but also realizing a real-life situation is not easy. It's a difficult thing to do. Now, luckily, our students are not only getting better in STEM and being more motivated, we also had enthusiastic teachers. But that was not easy. And it was not actually, it was, to be honest, it was not originally our target. Our target were improving the interest and knowledge of students in STEM. But we, through the process, working with teachers, we saw that our project had a major effect on them. First, they were very skeptical. They said, no, I'm not going to do this. I'm not going to work with that guy who has a different subject and align my lesson plan to the lesson plan of others. This is really hard for teachers, especially in our context, in our country. But they, through the process, when seeing what happened with the students and with themselves, because they had were being challenged to innovate their teaching, they became enthusiastic. And this is, I think, even the biggest, the biggest output, the most important output we reached with our project. We asked our teachers to innovate and their teaching. And that's why we continue in this. Now I switch my slides, I'm sorry. Near the end of the project, we provide our learning materials for free to the teachers, but we also want to continue to encourage them to innovate their teaching. So we are developing now in-service and pre-service training courses because we want teachers to help and give them tools to do creation of new learning materials, new learning environments, and spread out that virus of innovation to other teachers. And that is our dream job now. Thank you.
Thank you for the interesting presentation. So now we have some minutes for questions. Josef and Harry, do you want to ask something? But everybody is free to ask. There is a microphone somewhere. Coming.
Thank you. Thank you for your interesting presentation. I was wondering, you have done a lot of research. Did you distribute it also in the scientific community, and how did you do that? Like publications or papers or manuals or stuff like that, more also for the researchers?
Yes, since 2 years, about 2 years, we go to conferences and spread out also the scientific results, and we're writing, PhDs are doing the research, so they have to write publications, scientific publications. So we're spreading those research results as well. And if you want to, because I was a bit quick, I had to catch time. Sorry, this is our website. You can also see our research output on the website. I'm sorry.
Thank you.
Josef, and then there, please.
I'm also very inspired by your project. One of the problems that we often encounter in STEM is that each of the separate disciplines often have a separate approach in didactics. And in your integrated projects, somehow it should blend, which requires new skills of the teachers. How did you solve this problem, or didn't this problem exist?
First of all, it is very important to keep the separate courses because indeed they have their own didactics and their own research. We also ask teachers who are involved in the design process, at least, to also have a look at the literature and the findings around pedagogies and instructional strategies around misconceptions and so on. And further, I think it is really enriching to see how teachers almost teach each other when they are working in a multidisciplinary team. So they're really building on each other's knowledge. They're aligning their knowledge. They're aligning their strategies onto each other. So I think it's a question of and having them the pedagogies apart and having them integrated. I think, yeah, it's really inspiring.
Yes, I just had a question. I'm a teacher at one of those schools from Belgium, and I can only say that what you say is completely true. The students are more motivated. I only teach languages, but I can see that the science students are really getting stronger in this. The thing I was wondering, is it according to you or according to research and so on, a possibility that you would also integrate non-scientific subjects like languages, international projects, to add an extra dimension? Would you think that's valuable or not?
I think that's very, very valuable, but I think it's already hard enough to get only the STEM disciplines aligned and integrated. So let's start with this, and then I think we should broaden up and also make more connections among other courses, yeah.
Hi, I'm from Australia. We have STEM as well. It's very big. It seems to be a global phenomenon now. My question is about, I understand about encouraging and empowering women, girls and women, to get into STEM. What's the situation with the teachers, female teachers in STEM as role models? Currently.
Well, we have a lot of female teachers, but of course in the engineering and technology department, they are still in the minority. So there we don't have a lot of engineering technology teachers that can really be a role model for, we have them, but there are not a lot of them. So there we have also that kind of problem.
Is that changing? Do you think that's now changing with STEM? You're seeing a change?
There has been, in case of Flanders, there has been a slight increase in students wanting to study STEM now recently, and also female students or wanting to study STEM. Actually, I would like to add something to the gender issue. Actually, one of our master thesis students also studied in if teachers differ according to their own gender in the way they treat students during STEM classes. Actually, we didn't find any differences. So that's a very good news.
We have time for one question, if there is some. Maybe two, Marcel is telling me. But if there is no more, so we... Okay, Harry, I forget to say that Harry is the winner of last year. Yes, best practices. Want to ask? Yes.
I was wondering, you engage professionals in your project. Could you also, that's the professionals in the schools and you, Are there other professionals in researchers or teacher educators involved in your project? Could you tell us something about that?
Yeah, a few of the promoters of this project are actually involved in the teacher education. Yeah.